Remnant Audio presents Charles Dickens, A Christmas Carol, Part 3.
You old fool. Getting yourself all worked up over nothing. It's all in your imagination, it is. The first at 1, the second at 2. Well, I'm ready for you, whoever you are, and I tell you I will not be moved.
Scrooge jumped into his bed and blew out his candle, and sitting up to get his thoughts together, he felt that he was restored to consciousness in the right nick of time for a special purpose of holding a conference with a second messenger dispatched to him from Jacob Marley's intervention. He felt himself turn uncomfortably cold, and he began to wonder which of the curtains this specter would draw back. And so, he put them all aside with his own two hands, and lying down again, he established a sharp lookout all around the bed. You see, he wished to challenge the spirit at the very moment of its appearance, and he did not wish to be taken by surprise or to be made nervous. Now, being prepared for anything, he was not by any means prepared for nothing. And consequently, when the bell struck 2 and no shape appeared, he was taken with a violent fit of trembling. As he trembled, a bright light began to beam upon his face. He struggled to find the source of the light, but was unable to even hold his eyes open. And suddenly, a powerful voice echoed through his room.
Scrooge, are you coming, or do I have to come in there and collect you?
I'm coming!
He got up slowly, shuffled into his slippers, and ran to the door. But as he opened it, he was met with a great shock. It was his sitting room, there was no doubt about that, but it had undergone a surprising transformation. The walls and the ceiling were so hung with living green that it looked a perfect grove, and from every part of which bright gleaming berries glistened. The crisp leaves of holly, mistletoe, and ivy reflected the light as if so many little mirrors had been scattered there. And such a mighty blaze went roaring up the chimney as the dull hearth had never known in Scrooge's time. Heaped upon the floor to form a kind of a throne were turkeys, geese, poultry, brawn, great joints of meat, suckling pig, long links of sausages, minced pies, plump puddings, barrels of oysters, red-hot chestnuts, cherry-cheeked apples, juicy oranges, luscious pears, and seething bowls of punch that made the chamber dim with their delicious steam. In easy sit upon this couch, there sat a giant. Glorious to see, he bore a glowing torch in shape much like Plenty's horn, and he held it up, high up, in order to shed light upon Scrooge as he came peering around the corner.
Come in! Come in! And know me better, man! I am the ghost of Christmas present. Look upon me!
The ghost was clothed in one simple deep green robe, bordered with white fur. This garment was hung so loosely upon the figure that its capacious breast was bare. Its feet, observable beneath the ample folds of the garment, were also bare, and on its head it wore no other covering than a holly wreath, set here and there with shining icicles. Its dark brown curls were long and free as its genial face, its sparkling eye, its open hand, its unconstrained demeanor, and its joyful air.
You have never seen the like of me before.
Never?
Have never walked with my younger brothers.
I'm afraid I have not, actually. Have you had many brothers, Spirit?
1859, to be exact.
Tremendous family to provide for, I must say.
The ghost rose.
And now I see that I look at you. They have been telling me the truth about you. Actually, it's fallen utterly short of reality. I certainly have my work cut out.
I will have you know, I am a man of the highest moral principle.
If you're going to lie, at least try to make it believable. Ebenezer, sins of mankind are huge. A never-ending symphony of villainy, infamy, duplicity, deceit, and subterfuge. And no one's worse than Ebenezer Scrooge. Now, touch my robe.
Scrooge did as he was told, and held it fast. All vanished instantly, and they stood in the city streets on Christmas morning. The sky was gloomy, and the streets were choked up with dingy mist, half-thawed, half-frozen. There was nothing very cheerful in the climate or in the town, and yet there was an air of cheerfulness abroad. Scrooge and the ghost went on invisible into the suburbs of the town and straight into Scrooge's clerk's house. Mrs. Cratchit, Bob Cratchit's wife, was laying the tablecloth, assisted by young Miss Belinda Cratchit, second of her daughters, while Master Peter Cratchit plunged a fork into the saucepan of potatoes. And now, two smaller Cratchits, a boy and girl, came tearing in, screaming that outside of the baker's they had smelled the goose and known it for their own.
What has ever got your precious father, then, and your brother, Tiny Tim and Martha?
Here's Martha, Mother, cried the young Cratchits.
Oh my, now is that a goose to win prizes? Well done, Martha. Bless your heart alive, my dear.
Mrs. Cratchit kissing her a dozen times and taking off her shawl and bonnet for her with a vivacious zeal.
Oh, you're probably frozen. Come and sit down before the fire, dear. Have a warm, though, bless you.
Mother! Father's coming! Father's coming!
Said the younger Cratchits, who were everywhere all at once.
Hide, Martha!
So Martha hid herself, and in came Bob, their father, with at least 3 feet of comforter hanging down before him, and Tiny Tim upon his shoulder. Alas, for Tiny Tim, he bore a little crutch and had his leg supported by an iron frame.
What? Where's our Martha?
She's not coming.
Not coming? Upon Christmas Day?
Martha did not like to see him disappointed, even if it were only a joke. So she came out prematurely from behind the closet door and ran into his arms, while the two young Cratchits hustled Tiny Tim and carried him off to the washroom.
And how did little Tim behave?
Asked Mrs. Cratchit.
Ah, as good as gold, my love. And better. He gets thoughtful, sitting by himself so much. And he thinks the strangest things you ever heard. He told me, coming home, that he hoped that people saw him at church because he was a cripple, and it might be pleasant to them to remember upon Christmas Day who made lame beggars walk and blind men see.
Tim's crutch was heard upon the floor, and before another word was spoken, he was escorted by his brother and sister to his stool before the fire. And Bob turned up his cuffs, as if, poor fellow, they were capable of being made any more shabby. He compounded some hot mixture in a jug with gin, rum, honey, apples, and lemons, and stirred it round and round, and put it on the hob to simmer. Master Peter and the two ubiquitous young Cratchits went to fetch the goose. And there was such a bustle that ensued that you might have thought a goose was the rarest of all birds. And in truth, in that house, it was something very like it. Bob took Tiny Tim beside him. The two younger Cratchits set chairs for everybody until at last the dishes were set on and grace was said.
For what we are about to receive, may the Lord make us truly thankful. Amen.
It was a sufficient dinner for the whole family. The plates being changed by Mrs. Belinda, Mrs. Cratchit left the room alone to take the pudding up and to bring it in. And it was a marvelous pudding. Oranges and lemons, sweet brown sugar, spices, and of course, brandy. Bob Cratchit said that he regarded it as the
greatest success achieved by Mrs. Cratchit since our marriage.
At last, the dinner was all done. The cloth was cleared, the hearth swept, and the fire made up. And the compound in the jug being tested and considered perfect. Then all the Cratchit family drew around the hearth, and Bob served it out with beaming looks.
Christmas punch, a Cratchit family speciality. A Merry Christmas to us all, my dears. God bless us.
God bless us, everyone.
What an unpleasant child. You know, Scrooge, there are a few things more nauseating than seeing a happy family enjoying themselves at Christmas. Don't you agree?
Don't mock me, Spirit. Tell me, this Tiny Tim, is he very sick? Will he live?
I see a vacant seat in the corner, and a crutch without an owner. Carefully preserved. If these shadows remain unaltered by the future, then... Yes. Yes, the child will die. What's this? If he'd like to die, he'd better do it, and decrease the surplus population.
Scrooge hung his head to hear his own words quoted by the spirit.
It may be that in the sight of heaven, Ebenezer, you are more worthless and less fit to live than millions like this poor man's child.
Scrooge bent his head before the ghost's rebuke, and cast his eyes upon the ground. But he raised them speedily, hearing his own name.
To Mr. Scrooge, I give you Mr. Scrooge, the founder of our feast.
What are you trying to do, then? Ruin our Christmas?
Darling, Mr. Scrooge paid for the feast.
No, my love, you paid for the feast by earning the money to pay for it, 15 shillings a week, and not a penny's raise in 5 years. Oh, believe me, you've earned it. The founder of our feast, indeed. Oh, I wish I had him here. I'd give him a piece of my mind to feast on. He'd have indigestion for a month.
My dear, it's Christmas Day.
It should be Christmas Day, on which we drink the health of such an odious, stingy, hard, unfeeling man such as Mr. Scrooge. Oh, you know it is, Robert. Nobody knows better than you, my poor love.
My dear, Christmas Day.
Well, all right. I'll drink his health for your sake and the day's, not for his. Long life to him. Merry Christmas. Happy New Year.
The children drank the toast after. Scrooge was the ogre of the family. The mention of his name cast a dark shadow on the entire party, which was not dispelled for a full 5 minutes. The chestnuts were taken off the fire. More servings of Cratchit family punch were passed round and round, and by, they had a song by Tiny Tim.
On a beautiful day that I dream about, in a world I would love to see, is a beautiful place where the sun comes out and it shines in the sky for me. On this beautiful winter's morning, if my wish could come true somehow, then the beautiful day that I dream about would be here. And now...
There was nothing of high mark about this. They were not a handsome family. They were not well-dressed. Their shoes were not waterproof. Their clothes were scanty. But they were happy and grateful, pleased to be with one another, and content with the time they were given. And when they faded, they looked happier yet in the bright sprinklings of the spirit's tortured parting. Scrooge had his eye upon them, and especially on Tiny Tim, until the last glimpses of them faded away. By this time, it was getting dark and snowing pretty heavily. And as Scrooge and the spirit went along the streets, the brightness of the roaring fires and kitchens, parlors, and all sorts of rooms was wonderful. But now, without a word of warning from the ghost, they stood upon a bleak moor.
What place is this, spirit?
A place where miners live, who've labored in the bowels of the earth. But they know me. Come and see.
A light shone from the window of a hut, and swiftly they advanced towards it, passing through the wall of mud and stone. And they found a cheerful company assembled around a glowing fire. An old man and woman, with their children's children, and another generation beyond that, all decked out gaily in their holiday attire. The spirit did not tarry here, but bade Scrooge to hold on to his robe, and passing on above the moor, they sped out to sea. Built upon a dismal reef of sunken rocks, some league or so from shore, there stood a solitary lighthouse. But even here, two men who watched the light had made a fire that through the hole in the thick stone wall shot out a ray of brightness onto that awful sea. Joining their hands over a rough table at which they sat, they wished each other Merry Christmas over their can of grog. The ghost sped out again above the black and heaving sea, on and on, until being far away from any shore, they came upon a ship. They stood beside the helmsman at the wheel, the lookout on the bow, the officers who had the watch, dark, ghostly figures in their several stations, but every man among them hummed a Christmas tune, or had a Christmas thought, or spoke below his breath to his companion of some bygone Christmas day with homeward hopes belonging to it. It was a great surprise to Scrooge to hear a hearty laugh. It was as much a greater surprise to Scrooge to recognize it as his own nephew's and to find himself in a bright, dry, gleaming room with the spirit standing, smiling by his side and looking at the same nephew with approving affability.
He said that Christmas was a humbug, as I live. And he believed it, too.
Well, more shame for him, dear Fred.
Well, he is a comical old fellow, I'll tell you that. And not so pleasant as he might be, however. His offences carry their own punishment. And I am honestly sorry for him. I couldn't be angry with him if I tried. I ask you, who suffers by his ill will? He takes it into his head to dislike us, and he won't come and dine with us. What's the consequence? He loses out on some pleasant moment which could do him no harm. I tell you, he loses the companions that are far greater than any he can find in his own thoughts, or his mouldy old office, or his dusty old chambers. I meant to give him the same chance every year, whether he likes it or not. And hopefully one day he'll get wise and come and join us. And raises clerk's pay by 5 shillings a week. Lord knows he's earned it. And I think I shook him yesterday. I really do. Besides, if I can genuinely wish him a Merry Christmas, who is the most odious, bitter, and horrendous scabby miser in God's creation, then I know I am truly a man of goodwill. But I like Scrooge. Honestly,
I really do. I can't help but think that somewhere underneath that callous, heartless exterior beats the heart of a good man, waiting to come out.
It was the company's turn to laugh now at the notion of his shaking Scrooge. But being thoroughly good-natured and not much caring what they laughed at, so long as they laughed at any rate, he encouraged them in their merriment. But the whole scene passed, and Scrooge and the spirit were again upon their travels. Much they saw, and far they went, and many homes they visited. The spirit stood beside sick beds, and they were cheerful. On foreign lands, and they were close at home. By struggling men, and they were patient in their greater hope. By poverty, and it was rich. In almshouse, hospital, and jail, in misery and every refuge where vain man in his little brief authority had not made fast the door and barred the spirit out, he left his blessing, and he taught Scrooge his precepts. It was a long night, if it were only a night, but Scrooge had his doubts about this, because many Christmas holidays appeared to be condensed into the space of time that they passed. It was strange, too, that while Scrooge remained unaltered in his appearance, the ghost grew older, clearly older. Scrooge had observed this change, but hadn't spoke of it until they left the children's 12th night party, when, looking at the spirit as they stood together in the open place, he noticed that its hair was gray.
Our spirit's life's so short.
My life on this globe is very brief. Alas, my time is drawing near. I have only until midnight.
At his word, the chimes began ringing the 11:15.
Spirit, forgive me, but I see something strange and not belonging to yourself, but protruding from your skirts. Is it a foot or a claw?
It might be a claw, for all the flesh that there is upon it. Look here.
From the foldings of its robe, it brought forth two children. Wretched, abject, frightful, hideous, miserable. They knelt down at its feet and clung upon the outside of its garment.
Oh, man, look down here.
They were a boy and a girl. Yellow, meager, ragged, scowling, wolfish, but prostrate too in their humility. Where graceful youth should have filled their features out and touched them with its freshest kiss, a stale and shriveled hand, like that of old age, had pinched and twisted them and pulled them into shreds. Where angels might have sat enthroned, devils lurked and glared out menacingly. No degradation, no perversion of humanity in any grade through all the mysteries of wonderful creation has monsters half so horrible and dread as thee. Scrooge started back appalled.
Spirit, are they yours?
They are man's. Beware them both. But most of all, beware this boy. For on his brow I see that written which is doom. Unless the writing be erased, this boy is ignorance, and this girl is want. Deny it. Slant are those who tell it ye. Admit it for your faction's purpose, and make it worse.
Have they no refuge? No resources?
Are there no prisons? Are there no workhouses? Remember Ebenezer Scrooge. It's a funny old life. And suddenly, you're not there anymore.
The bell struck 12. Scrooge looked about him for the ghost and saw it not. But as the last stroke ceased to vibrate, He remembered the prediction of old Jacob Marley and lifted up his eyes. A solemn phantom, draped and hooded, came like a mist along the ground towards him. Slowly, gravely, silently, the very air that the spirit moved on seemed to scatter gloom and misery. It was shrouded in a deep black garment, which concealed its head and face. Yes, its entire form was shrouded. It left nothing of it visible, save one outstretched hand. But for this, it would have been difficult to detach the figure from the night and separate it from the darkness by which it was surrounded. Its mysterious presence filled him with a solemn dread.
I am in the presence of the spirit of Christmas is yet to come.
The upper portion of the garment was contracted for an instant in its folds, as if the spirit had inclined its head. That was the only answer he received.
And you were about to show me the shadows of things to come. Is that so, spirit?
Again, the spirit only nodded. But Scrooge was all the worse for this. It thrilled him with a vague, uncertain horror to know that behind the dusky shroud there were ghostly eyes intently fixed upon him.
I must confess, I fear you more than any spirit I have seen tonight. But as I know it is your purpose to do me good, I am willing to bear you company. Will you speak to me? I know the night is waning fast, and time is precious to me. Lead on, spirit, lead on!
This has been a Remnant Audio production. All voices performed by Calion Maston. Music production by Seva Markov. Join us tomorrow night for A Christmas Carol, Part 4.